Well, we've just crossed into June, which means that it's summer, at least on the calendar, not maybe the weather. But summer is the season in which trees and plants grow their fruit. But this summer here at Village Church, we're going to think and talk about the kind of fruit that should be growing all year round in the lives of those of us who are Christ followers. The Bible in Galatians chapter 5 contains a well-known list of 9 character traits that are referred to as the fruit of the Spirit. And each Sunday for the next 2.5 months, we are all going to become fruit inspectors. Not only inspecting what the Bible teaches about the fruit of the Spirit, but also inspecting our own lives to determine whether and to what extent this fruit is evident in our daily attitudes and our conduct. This 11-week inspection of the fruit of the Spirit is entirely in keeping with what our church is all about. The reason VCG exists is to help people follow Jesus more so that more follow Jesus. And this summer we're going to focus on the front half of this purpose statement. Examining the fruit of the Spirit will encourage us and equip us to follow Jesus more. One of the ongoing life steps on our journey of walking with Jesus is learning how to walk like Jesus. In other words, you and I are following Jesus more and more when we are growing more and more like Him. And of course, bearing fruit is an obvious sign of growth. Apples don't grow on dead or unhealthy apple trees. Likewise, the fruit of the Spirit only grows in people who are spiritually alive and thriving. And no one in world history was ever more spiritually alive and thriving than Jesus Christ. No one on this planet has ever exhibited the fruit of the Spirit like Jesus did. In fact, the fruit of the Spirit is a portrait of Jesus Christ. His life on earth was the epitome of all 9 pieces of fruit in balanced perfection. He loved both God and people perfectly. He exuded perfect joy and exhibited perfect peace. He was perfectly good. And a human being could never be any kinder or gentler or more patient, faithful, and self-controlled than Jesus. So if we aspire to grow more like Jesus, as we should, then the fruit of the Spirit is one of the best measuring sticks to assess how we are doing. But when I say that helping people follow Jesus more and becoming more like Him is what VCG is all about, I am not suggesting that this church can produce this fruit in your life. The Bible doesn't call these 9 character traits the fruit of church attendance or the fruit of church involvement. These virtues won't show up in your life just because you show up here at church. This portrait of Jesus is called the fruit of the Spirit, which means that VCG can't make you more like Jesus. Only the Holy Spirit can do that. Now think for a moment about this phrase, of the Spirit. The word of indicates the source of the fruit. Just like if you hear the phrase, the sermons of Pastor Todd, you don't think that this is referring to sermons about Pastor Todd, but sermons that were produced and presented by me. So the New Living Translation rightly takes the literal biblical phrase, the fruit of the Spirit, and knows that it's talking about source, and so it makes the meaning explicit by translating it this way. The Holy Spirit produces this kind of fruit in our lives. The fruit of the Spirit means the Holy Spirit produces this kind of fruit in our lives. So again, only the Holy Spirit can grow this special fruit in you and me. And the role of Village Church is simply to encourage and to challenge and to assist each one of us to tap into the productive power of the Holy Spirit. As we sang in worship today, we need His presence more than anything. Now, since for the next 11 weeks, we're going to consider what the Holy Spirit produces in our lives, it would probably be a good idea in this introductory sermon to remind all of us who the Holy Spirit is. And notice that I said who He is, not what He is. The Holy Spirit is a who, not a what. The Holy Spirit is a person, not a thing. projected for you now are a few short excerpts of statements that Jesus himself made about the Holy Spirit in the Gospel of John. You will notice that Jesus refers to the Holy Spirit as he, not it. Some people have mistakenly thought that the Holy Spirit is some sort of vague, mysterious, impersonal, Star Wars-like force that we hope will be with us. And probably the use of the word ghost instead of spirit in the Old English Bibles hasn't helped us in understanding the identity of the Holy Spirit, maybe even making it more confusing for folks. The Holy Ghost sounds ominous and scary, unless we think of him as some sort of friendly ghost like Casper in the old cartoons. But then we're tempted to dismiss the Holy Spirit not as a real person, and we don't take him seriously. It is true that the Holy Spirit is a spirit, which means that he is a person without a physical body. But that doesn't make him any less of a person, because the essential characteristics of personhood are intellect, emotions, and will. God is spirit, but he doesn't have a body. He has intellect, emotions, and will. Jesus Christ, God's Son, became a human being and now has a body, but God in his essence and nature is bodiless. He is a spirit. He's still a person, intellect, emotion, and will. And the Holy Spirit qualifies. The Bible tells us that the Holy Spirit has a mind. He teaches the truth. The Bible tells us that he has feelings. The Bible tells us that he can be insulted and grieved. And the Holy Spirit has a will. The Bible tells us, for instance, that he is the one who decides who in the church gets which spiritual gifts. Now, things or forces can't think, feel, and choose. But the Holy Spirit does think, feel, and choose because he is a person. Now, the Bible also teaches that the Holy Spirit is a divine person. He's not only a person, he's God. He is the third member of the Trinity. Notice how Jesus, who is God the Son, includes all three persons of the Trinity in the same sentence twice. The Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name. And again, the Spirit of truth, who goes out from the Father, he will testify about me. You see, the Holy Spirit truly deserves to be spoken of in the same sentence as the Father and the Son, because he is equal with the Father and the Son in terms of deity. All three of them are equally and fully God. And all three of them work together in perfect harmony. But even though the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit are equal persons, they have different ranks or functions. This is why Jesus once said that the Father is greater than I. God the Son and God the Father are equally God, but Jesus on earth as the incarnate Son said the Father is greater than I. And likewise, in the passage before you, Jesus, as he refers to the Holy Spirit, says that his job is to glorify me. This means, therefore, that God the Father is the top-ranking member of the Trinity, Jesus, God the Son, is the second-ranking member, and the Holy Spirit is the third-ranking member. We understand, militarily speaking, that as fellow human beings, a general, a colonel, and a major are equal persons in value and worth. But in their work as officers in the same army, the general is greater than the colonel, and the colonel is greater than the major. Likewise, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit are all equally God, but the Father as general is greater than the Son as colonel, who is greater than the Holy Spirit as major. That is, to get the job done of creating the world, of providing salvation, of answering prayer, of distributing gifts and ministries in the church, they all work together in harmony, but they each have a different role. With regard to the work of salvation, for instance, the Father took the lead and he directed the plan and he sent the Son into the world, who died and rose again from the dead for us. And now it is the Holy Spirit, we are in the era of the Holy Spirit, who has come to apply the work of the Son into the lives of people, including the production of fruit that makes us more like Jesus. Now notice in the words of Jesus, the Holy Spirit's primary job is to draw attention to Jesus. The Father sent the Spirit in Christ's name as his representative so that the Holy Spirit would testify about Jesus and would glorify Jesus. I've thought of this many times as I drive down Hunt Club Road at night and see our church in that beautiful facade in the front with that white cross, that beautiful white cross, which represents Jesus Christ. Now, interestingly, at night, if you drive down the road, you really wouldn't see that cross very well unless there were floodlights, as there are, at the base of the wall that shine light up under the cross so that it's noticed and can be seen. Folks, the Holy Spirit is the floodlights of the Trinity. The Holy Spirit's job is to shine the light on Jesus, put Jesus in the limelight so that people in the world and in the church see Jesus and think about Jesus and want to become like Jesus. It shouldn't surprise us that the fruit of the Spirit, if it's manifested in our life, will make us more like Jesus, because that's the Holy Spirit's job, to make Jesus the hero and to make us all more like him. You think the number one goal of the Holy Spirit, in fact, for Christians, is to grow them into fruit-filled people who will look like Jesus, who will live like Jesus, so that the people around us who don't yet know Jesus will be drawn to him. Why will they be drawn to Jesus? Because they will be seeing us, his followers, in an attractive display of Christ-like love and joy and peace and patience and kindness and goodness and faithfulness and gentleness and self-control. So the Holy Spirit is kind of the shy one of the Trinity. He doesn't want to be in the limelight. He says, no, the focus is on Jesus. I want to testify about him. I want to glorify him. And so the Holy Spirit quietly works within us to produce his fruit in our lives so that we'll become more like Jesus. And this means that it's not all up to you to grow more like Jesus. You can't become a fruitful Christian just by trying harder. This was the mistake made by the Galatian church, the very Christians to whom the Holy Spirit, through the Apostle Paul, originally presented the list of the fruit of the Spirit. These Christians in the village church of Galatia were being foolish because they thought they had to or they could produce the fruit of the Spirit on their own without the power of the Spirit. And so Paul writes, Galatians 3:3, "How foolish can you be? After starting your Christian life in the Spirit, why are you now trying to become perfect by human effort?" Now, I like how the version of the Bible called The Message translates this same passage, so I've included it. "For only crazy people would think that they could complete by their own efforts what was begun by God. If you weren't smart enough or strong enough to begin it, how do you suppose that you could perfect it?" What Paul is saying here is that if you know Jesus Christ as your Savior, if you're a Christ follower today, then before you even came to Christ, it was the Spirit's work that convicted you of your sin. It was the Spirit's work that convinced you of the truth of the gospel. It was the Spirit's work that regenerated new life, spiritual life within you. If you and I are Christ followers today, it is only because the Spirit has done a transforming work in our lives that has enabled us to begin the journey. And now, folks, the only way that you and I can complete this spiritual journey is if we rely on that same Holy Spirit to finish the job that he started. Some of you here this morning are thinking, "Oh boy, all summer long, I'm going to be listening to sermons on becoming more loving and more joyful and more peaceful, more patient, more faithful, more gentle, more self-controlled. And, oh, where am I going to get the strength? I know I'm not measuring up. How am I going to find the strength?" And you're already giving yourself a pep talk about trying harder to be all that you should be. But that's like an apple tree branch trying harder to produce apples. No, the apple tree branch will produce apples if he stays attached to the tree trunk and draws life and fruit-growing sap from the tree's roots. It's not all up to the tree branch, and it's not all up to you and me. The key to growing fruit in our lives is not trying harder, but staying connected to the life-giving power of the Holy Spirit and daily drawing from him his fruit-growing sap. Now, that doesn't mean that we don't make any effort at all, but declaring that it's not all up to you might be misleading if we don't also affirm that it's not all up to the Holy Spirit either. If it were all up to the Holy Spirit, then we wouldn't need to hear sermons on the fruit of the Spirit. If we're all up to the Holy Spirit, we could just sit back on our deck chairs this summer and sip iced tea and wait for the Holy Spirit automatically to do his work of making us more loving and more joyful and more peaceful and more patient, etc. Frankly, if it were all up to the Holy Spirit to make all of us more fruitful, then he's not doing a very good job in a lot of us. He must be neglecting some of us, because there are varying degrees of fruit production among Christians. If we're all up to the Holy Spirit, then he's negligent on some of us. He's shirking his responsibility. But that's not the case. The reason there are varying degrees of fruit in Christians' lives is not because the Holy Spirit is letting us down. It's because we Christians aren't measuring up to cooperating with him. Just a few verses after Paul lists the fruit of the Spirit, he goes on to speak about our responsibility in all this. He reminds us that we will only reap a fruitful harvest when we plant good seeds in good soil and in good conditions for growth. Paul writes in Galatians 6, just a few verses later, "Don't be misled. No one makes a fool of God. What a person plants, he will harvest. The person who plants selfishness, ignoring the needs of others, ignoring God, harvests a crop of weeds. And that's all he'll have to show for his life is weeds. But the one who plants in response to God, letting God's Spirit do the growth work in him, well, that person's going to harvest a crop of real life, eternal life." You see, the Bible is telling us here, in the same context of the fact that it is the fruit of the Spirit, is telling us we have a job to do too. We need to sow the right kind of seed, because we reap what we sow. A farmer doesn't plant soybeans if he wants to grow corn. He doesn't plant a peach tree sapling if he eventually wants to eat pears. So we need to plant seeds and saplings that are provided by the Holy Spirit instead of seeds and saplings that are providing from our sin nature within and from the secular world around us. And even if we do plant good seed, Holy Spirit seed, we still need to stay involved like hardworking farmers who irrigate, who fertilize, who cultivate the crop. The farmer can't actually grow the fruit, of course, but he can cultivate the conditions that provide an environment conducive for growth. And that's our job in the Christian life. Only the Holy Spirit can produce the fruit in our lives. But we must cooperate with him by cultivating the conditions in which his fruit can develop in us. Let me say it again. You and I can't grow love. We can't grow joy or peace or patience or kindness or goodness or faithfulness or gentleness or self-control in our lives. But we can cultivate the development of these fruit of the Spirit by working in partnership with him. Our job is to till the hard soil, to clear the rocks, to pull the weeds that threaten to prevent the fruit from growing. That is, if you and I spend all of our time reading the wrong kinds of books, watching the wrong kinds of TV and shows and movies, looking at the wrong kinds of images on the computer, pursuing the wrong kinds of leisure activities, and being influenced by bad company, we're not only not planting the right kinds of seeds, we are allowing our soil to grow hard and the rocks and the weeds to accumulate in our lives. Since we reap what we sow, our job is to sow to the Spirit. That is to plant seeds from the Spirit containing the life of God in them, and then practicing like a hardworking farmer the spiritual disciplines like prayer and Bible reading and fellowship and worship with other Christians. These disciplines provide the water and the sunshine and the nutrients to grow a spiritual crop of fruit. You see, sometimes we lose sight of what is the means and what is the end. A lot of people think, oh, I need to pray, I need to read the Bible, I need to go to church, I need to fellowship with other Christians, because that's what good Christians do, and that becomes the end in itself. But frankly, folks, the measure of a mature Christian is not how many times you show up in church, how many times you open your Bible, or even how many times you pray. The measure of a strong Christian is how much love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, and self-control is in your life. You see, the spiritual disciplines are not an end in themselves. They're a means to becoming more fruitful in our Christian life. Frankly, if you are already growing in a bumper crop of love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, and goodness in your life, and you're not praying or reading the Bible or coming to church, then don't pray, read Bible, come to church, because you're already there. I say that rather facetiously because I've never met anybody who could do that. The only way we can really grow the crop of the Spirit's fruit is to be the hardworking farmer that plants Spirit seeds and then practices the disciplines that allow these things to grow up in our lives. We pray, we read the Bible, we come to church, not because we have to, or not because that's how we score brownie points with God, or that's how we impress other people with our devoutness. We pray, we come to church, we read the Bible, because if we don't, weeds, rocks, hard soil, nothing grows like it should. Now, this will never be easy. This will be a lifelong challenge. It's highly significant that the list of the fruit of the Spirit in Galatians 5 is embedded in a context here where Paul describes living the Christian life as a fight. The message of the Bible is that cultivating the Spirit's fruit is a constant battle. Now, that's the bad news. But the good news is that we have the Holy Spirit living inside of us if we are believers in Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit makes the fight winnable. In verses 16 and 17, Paul analyzes this fight that all Christ followers experience. And it reveals that our only chance of winning is relying on the Holy Spirit, who supplies the power we need to sin less and less and become more and more like Jesus. You see, you're not going to be sinless as a Christian until you get to heaven. But that's no reason just to wring your hands and fold up your hands and say, okay, I'm not going to be sinless till I get to heaven, so I guess it's okay if I sin till I get there. No, the Holy Spirit's agenda is to help you sin less and less and less and less until you become sinless. The Holy Spirit's agenda right now in our lives is to so work and make us more like Jesus and more holy and more heavenly so that when we get to heaven, we won't be so shocked. You see, holiness right now reduces the culture shock when we get to heaven. Paul goes on to talk about this fight that's within us. As Christians, he says, we are walking battlefields. We have two opposing forces at work in us, the Holy Spirit and our sinful nature. Have you come to realize that just because you became a Christian, your sin nature doesn't go away? And many times every day, you and I, in this fight, must choose whether we're going to do what the Holy Spirit is prompting us to do or whether we're going to do what our sin nature is pressuring us to do. Paul describes this relentless conflict this way. The sinful nature inside me wants to do evil, which is just the opposite of what the Spirit wants. And the Spirit gives us desires that are opposite of what the sinful nature desires. These two forces, he says, are constantly fighting each other, so you are not free to carry out your good intentions. I don't know about you, but that describes my Christian life at times. I want to carry out good intentions. Lord, I know what your will is. I want to do what's right. I do want to do what's good, but when I find myself in that situation, I also find that right there lurking at the surface within me is this opposing force that says, oh yeah, we're not going to do that. We're going to go the different way. The old hymn describes this inclination towards sin very well. We sing it whenever we sing the hymn, Come Thou Fount. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. Man, I know when I'm singing that, I'm singing reality in my life. Oh, I so much want to live for God. I so much want to produce His fruit in my life. I want the Holy Spirit to guide me and all the rest, but I have this sin nature within me that is fighting, and boy, am I prone to wander. Lord, I feel it. I'm prone to leave the God I love. And this sinful nature, which is still within us as Christians, works much like gravity does. Gravity never lets up. Gravity never takes a break. It unceasingly pulls downward on us. And that's what our sin nature does. Well, let's put it in terms of an airplane in flight, because this basic science principle has always helped me understand how the sanctification of a Christian, the making of us holy by the Holy Spirit works. There are four forces at work on an airplane in flight. Two positive ones and two negative ones. The negative forces at the top there and at the left on the chart are constantly working to bring the plane down. These are natural forces of gravity, which keeps pulling the plane down, and drag or wind resistance, which keeps pushing the plane back and slowing it down. They're always there. They're always at work. The two positive forces, which are at the bottom and at the right, are aerodynamic forces. They are called lift and thrust. They are provided by the wings of the plane, and that's the lift, and then the thrust is provided by the engines of the plane. Now, the lift obviously raises the plane upward, and the thrust powers the plane forward. Now, I ask you the question, why does the airplane fly? It's not because the lift and the thrust totally eliminates the drag and the gravity. Those keep fighting. But the reason a plane flies is because the forces of lift and thrust are stronger than the forces of gravity and drag. The plane stays airborne not because it destroys gravity or eliminates drag. These negative forces remain constantly at work, but they are counteracted. They are overcome by the work of the wings and the engines to keep it lifted up and thrusting forward. Hopefully you see how this applies in your life. We're the airplane. As a Christian, we're seeking to stay airborne. We're seeking to climb higher and higher towards a fruitful life. And you know what? My sin nature within me constantly is the gravity and the drag that's pulling me down and pushing me back. And it will, unless I tap into the power of the Spirit, His lift and His thrust. If I tap into the power of Spirit, He is stronger than gravity and drag, and He can keep me moving forward. The aerodynamic forces of the Spirit are powerful enough to counteract and overcome our indwelling sin nature, and that's what enables us to climb higher and higher in fruitful living. So the question that will be coming up to us again and again this summer is this: what are we doing to diminish, not eliminate, but diminish the sinful forces of gravity and drag in our life? What are you doing to counteract those negative forces? Well, you can't do it on your own. What are you doing to tap into the Spirit's power, who has the force to lift and thrust in your life? He's the engine. He's the wings. What are you doing to harness His energy, the forces of His Spirit? My prayer is that all of us who follow Jesus and have the Holy Spirit in our lives this summer will gain altitude. We'll gain altitude spiritually. I didn't think about it in the first service, but when I was singing The Power of Your Love in the second service here, you know what you and I were singing? I will soar with you. Your Spirit leads me on in the power of your love. You see, that's exactly what we're praying for in our lives, that we will soar with the Holy Spirit. We will climb higher and higher with Him, and we can only do it because He provides the lift and the thrust in our lives. Let me summarize the partnership between the Holy Spirit and us. It boils down to this. When it comes to growing His fruit in our lives, in essence, this is what the Bible teaches. Without His power, we can't. But without our cooperation, He won't. That's theology 101 about getting holy in a nutshell. We can't do it alone, and the Holy Spirit won't do it alone. It is the fruit of the Spirit, so only He can produce it. But it is fruit, so we reap what we sow. Now I want to give you one final word of encouragement. The Holy Spirit is all about making you and me more holy. Shouldn't surprise us, holy is His first name. Holy is His agenda for our lives. But in the New Testament, the Holy Spirit is called other things. That's His main name. Jesus, in the passage we looked at earlier, called Him the Spirit of Truth. And there's a passage in Scripture in the New Testament that calls Him the Spirit of Grace. We need to remember this about the Holy Spirit as He guides us on our journey. Oh, He is definitely going to call out to us which way we need to turn and which way we need to go to become more holy. He's like the voice of your GPS in our car, if I can change the metaphor from a plane to a car. The Holy Spirit's voice is like that GPS voice. He's always wanting to guide us. He's always wanting us to keep in step with Him. He wants us to make holy choices. He wants us to live holy. And so if we're going to become more holy, we need to turn the way that He tells us to turn. We will. We'll become more holy if we keep in step with the Spirit. But none of us are Jesus. Our lives are far from perfect. We all have a long way to go in arriving at Christ-like love, joy, peace, etc. In this life, we'll never fully arrive at our destination of perfect Christ-likeness. That will be when we get to heaven. And so, I don't know about you, but I often make wrong turns and get off course. But I want to remind you today that same voice of the GPS, The Holy Spirit, who's giving you directions to make you more holy, is also the one who can bring recalculating grace into our lives. The Holy Spirit is also that voice in your car's GPS that keeps recalculating when you go astray. Sometimes the GPS voice tells me that I need to go back to where I was before I made the wrong turn, and so I can start obeying it, the voice from there. And the Spirit of grace will also do the same in our lives. He will prompt you at times to return to where you deviated off the right road so that you can make things right from back there. But I found that the GPS voice in my car often takes a different approach. It gets me back on course, not by getting me back to where I went wrong, but by continuing to move me forward right from where I am now. And so the voice gives me a new opportunity to obey directions. And if I start listening to the voice, then I will get back on course and get where I need to go. And you know, the Holy Spirit has that ability too. He uses more than one approach as he recalculates for the journey. He has the perfect wisdom, the Holy Spirit does, to know when we need to go back to where we were. And he knows when it's better to proceed from where we are. Either way, folks, you can trust the guidance of the Holy Spirit. He is able to get us back on track despite our many wrong turns. I don't know about you, but I want to praise God for his recalculating grace today. You know, and it's important that we keep this in balance, because this summer there's going to be some convicting things said. Every week you come in and go, oh, wow, I'm not nearly as loving as I should be. I'm not nearly as joyful as I should be. I'm not nearly as peaceful as I should be. I'm not nearly as patient as I should be. And don't stop listening to that voice of the Holy Spirit that's trying to give you directions to become more holy. Listen to that voice. But don't become so despairing and say, oh, I'll never measure up. I'm so far short. How could God love me? How could I consider myself a Christian? God is gracious. The same God who is the Holy Spirit is the Spirit of grace, and he is ready to take you when you've gone off course and get you back on course. Don't give up. God is not going to give up on you. The Holy Spirit is a gracious and forgiving GPS, godly positioning system. So let's keep in step with the Spirit. Amen? Stand with me as I close in prayer. God, as is often the case, it's going to be so important for us as a people this summer to keep our balance. Because I know there's going to be some people here, maybe some of us will be like this some weeks, where we'll come in and say, you know, I don't really feel like becoming more holy. I'm complacent. I'm content with where I'm at. And God, help us to listen to the Holy Spirit. Help us to cooperate with him and his agenda to make us more like Jesus. But God, there's also going to be times when we're just a little overwhelmed and discouraged and say, wow, will I ever measure up? Will I ever make any progress? And God, in those cases, help us to remember that this same Holy Spirit is the Spirit of grace. Give us the wisdom, the Lord, to know the difference and to keep these things in balance. And I pray that by the end of this summer, the people of Village Church, including myself, will be more fruitful than ever. That you will grow the crop of the Spirit's fruit this summer, and that Village Church, as a church and as individual people, will become more loving, more joyful, more peaceful, more patient, more kind, more good, more faithful, more gentle, and more self-controlled. Do your work in us, Holy Spirit, we pray. In Jesus' name, whom you came to represent. And all of God's people say, amen. You are dismissed. There are people up here to pray with you if you'd like to pray.
When I can see you, I know you're there. When I can feel you, I will not fear. I will trust in you, and I will not be afraid. When the battle close at hand, I know you're with me to help me stand. I will trust in you.